Oh, all of them.
I
Thank you. sisters, family and friends, students, classmates, faculty, elementary school, middle school, and high school faculty, AES staff, board members, and seniors. Welcome to the American Embassy School Class of 2013 Commencement Exercises. Thank you all so much for being here this evening. Thank you as well to all of our family and friends scattered around the planet this evening, but with us in spirit. We are all such integral parts of this beloved community. I would like to introduce the valedictorian of our senior class, who will offer the opening remarks to our graduation program, Addie Mara. Addie Mara.
Making our own decisions, pursuing our own goals, being driven by our own ambition. While our hearts may fill with fear, anxiety, excitement, and ambition when we look to the future, it is imperative that we hold with us the sentiment that success is not gauged by the result, but by the hard work and determination behind pursuing that result.
Things he found confusing, things that had bias, and then after you were done, you would retreat, and he you would analyze. And if you found an inaccuracy, you would pose a question. This is the mindset of a skeptic. It is one that wishes not to rest lazily. It wants proof, it wants questions, it wants to learn. And all of you have that little skeptic within you. What's that, you don't? Well, if you check underneath your chairs, I'm sure one has been invited by the ESA. You see, for the majority of my life, I was told what was right and what was wrong. I was told that Indians and pilgrims got along and they had Thanksgiving together, but strangely, I never found any Native Americans in any of the Thanksgivings I was invited to, and I was content to believe that they had simply lost their invitation. And I was told that oil and water don't mix, and that Vikings have horns, and that Paul Revere shouted out, "The British are coming, the British coming, the British are coming," and George Washington had ivory teeth that couldn't tell a lie. And whenever I would bother to ask, "Are you sure?" the response was always, "Yeah, for sure." And so they told me other things. They told me that Lincoln freed the slaves with his own two hands, and that Christopher Columbus found America. He was lost in his other pair of jeans when he found this world. And that the Mayans built great civilizations up and down the American continent. I'm like, wait, you just said that Christopher Columbus was the first person to find America.
Yes, he did.
But the Native Americans were already there.
Yes.
So he wasn't the first. This was the first time I had to reconcile the fact that things that were not true were considered to be true, were taught to me to be true. And it was my first encounter with the chaos that is real life. And I had to ask myself, why? Sitting in that skeptic's room, I had to ask myself, why? And then I got older. We all get older. I let the skeptic hang around. He paid rent. He was okay. But I forgot what I learned at one point, so I had to go to another group of people who were destined to teach me more things I would eventually forget, and that is what we call high school. And amidst the turmoil that is the life of an expat student, we all found our way here, to this continent, subcontinent, to AES. And though our journeys here were varied in terms of the degrees of enthusiasm, in terms of our purpose, and though we were all unsure, we found here our friends, our allies, yes, our intellectual partners, and even our enemies. But in this world, our cultures emphasize independence and divisions. I was told that unity was impossible, but I was also told that non-unity was impossible, so I was understandably confused. Then I figured out non-unity is not a word, it's disunity. But we found each other nonetheless. Sometimes over tandoori chicken, sometimes in the breezeway over novels, lemonade, and in the occasional times we'd work over the AES internet. And we continue to say to ourselves, so what? So what? This is the rallying cry of our generation. So what? And this is the part that I find the most interesting. A web of connections arising from a group of people moving back and forth across the globe, screaming out, so what, to a world that is spinning faster and faster until the word distance is one of the past, until culture and geography are no longer the dominant giants that they once were. Here at AES, the world and we have converged. In cafeterias, in hallways, in classrooms, on the field, on the stage, and we have proved that we can stand together as individuals and be a single graduating class. Well, actually, we're sitting. It was at AES, in this fertile academic environment, that I finally found the answer to the question about why oil and water don't mix. It's not because of the density. There are many things with different densities that mix, for example, orange juice and water, orange juice and elephants. But the fundamental structure of oil and water stops them from mixing. They are fundamentally immiscible. Oh wait, that totally destroys the metaphor I was going for. Could an IB student perhaps tell me what I should do next?
Just make it up.
It hides the complexity of the situation from us, and therefore it is a half-truth. And because it is a half-truth, it is the same as the idea that we could not get along. These are all falsehoods. These are all half-lies. These are things that we have proved can happen. And so, our world rewards conformity. And dissent is only tolerated when it is convenient. And when you discover that AES prizes critical thinking, You know it must be special, and it is here that I learned the true purpose of education, which is teaching you how to think. And my inner skeptic was delighted to have finally found a home, because when I came here gangly and skinny-armed and with glasses, a real Indian Harry Potter, how do you put it? I realized that we are privileged to have here teachers who love to explore everything to the fullest extent, who make education about understanding, not about memorization, and who remember what it was like to be not yet an adult, but more than a child, and who have the ability to give us great strength and simultaneously take it away from us with chapter tests. In many ways, AES is an ideal of what we hope to find in our future. It represents a paradise, a haven ensconced in a world where cows are the answer to recycling, where complex problems can be solved with duct tape, and where the FRRO is treated as a seasonal virus to be avoided at all costs. And so it is now, as we venture forth from this space, as we lose our paradise, that we realize the tools that AES has given us. And so it is now that we must see that these half-truths, these convenient truths, are just empty spaces waiting to be filled with knowledge we have yet to acquire. They are that which makes our skeptic very excited and makes him scratch away within our minds. And we are a restless bunch. We will find a cause, and we will defend it, just like every other generation stretching back to the beginning of time. But we are different, because we must look at a troubled world skeptically, without being cynical. For this brief moment, we will celebrate our graduation. We will celebrate a point in our lives where we burn the brightest, where our memories are so vivid we often have trouble discerning between what really happened and the actual events. And though we may not know what the future holds in these tumultuous and whirling times, we can be confident that we have learned the means and the method, and that there remains so much in the world that is open to us. We have entered to learn, and having done so, we now leave to serve. But I know there is one thing that I will never be skeptical of. I know one thing that all these students before me will never be skeptical of, and that is the love that my parents have given me. That is the all that they've done for me. I cannot thank them enough, and there's no way that they can be skeptical of me either because I'm dead. But I want to say on behalf of the entire graduating class, to my mom, to my grandmother, my other grandmother, grandfather as well. Thank you very much for everything. Thank you. And we hope that we will do you proud in the future.
About all the things that I had got wrong during my 20s. the decade that you are about to embark on. It's a nice bit. You read it too, Fish. Contrary to the advice that it offered, I fell in love at 23. This is mistake number 19 in their list of 20 major mistakes. The lone wolf is the only way forward. I spent a lot of my 20s not doing much. Not doing much on the beach, not doing much with friends, running around the field. Mistake number 12 in their list. Billionaire Mark Cuban did not have a day off in 7 years. I found a career that I really like, teaching. And I decided that I should give it a go for a while. This is mistake number 11. It warns that those who settle into a job in their 20s will end up with a minivan and taking their kids to soccer practice when they get to their 40s. Well, I drive a minivan, and I take my son to soccer practice, and I'm only 35, so hi, I'm ahead of your curve. I follow the crowd in my 20s at times instead of forging against it. This is mistake number 9. I'm such a sheep, but sometimes I thought it better to watch others to see how they do. I've also failed to energize those around me on a constant basis. This is mistake number 8. There were times when watching 7 episodes of Lost, eating a large pizza, a bucket of chicken, and way too much cheap red wine were infinitely more appealing than socializing and energizing everyone around me. Then I got married at 25. Silly me. Mistake number 6. This is a massive error. Save your money and your mental energy for something else. At least that's what Elite Daily told me. And then my son was born when I was 28. Mistake number 3. No kids. The road to success is not paved with having the responsibilities of children. Did I really fail so badly in my 20s? Did my lack of planning for my future self mean that I ended up in a dead-end job with a family that just ruined everything? Far too few connections to the correct sort of people. In fact, shouldn't I be sort of a white, English, middle-class Jay-Z by now? But doesn't the fact that I'm happy? I love my job. I love my friends. I adore my wife and children. Doesn't that mean that I'm doing okay? Doing well, even? Dare I say it, despite my complete lack of planning in my 20s, I'm doing great. Well, as I wondered the impact of my 20s, I read the second article, which is about a chap called James Rhodes. In his 20s, James quit being an investment banker and became a pianist, something that he had dreamed about since he was 9. James advised me, it wasn't just to me the article, but that's how I read things. James advised me that rather than going to the gym and getting a six-pack, which my wife and I hopefully assume voyeuristic others would find alluring, I should buy a piano, or some canvases, or some notebooks, and create something that lets her know that I love her, whilst fulfilling my creative needs. He said, why spend my free time scrolling through Twitter and Facebook looking for brags, bromance, people to hate on, and cute cats, and tidbits, and gossip, and travel ideas in a world where people have simply given up or been beaten into submission by the sleepwalk of work, rubbish TV, long-term financial planning, and all the ideas that go with being a grown-up? Why do that when I could be unleashing the inner creative? Rhodes then revealed that in becoming a concert pianist and unleashing the inner creative James, he went to a mental hospital for 9 months, lost 35 pounds, most of his dignity, and his wife. So maybe creativity slightly overrated in that sense. But the point that Rhodes makes is that rather than plotting every step, maybe we should just throw ourselves at our passions. Define what we love and let that light the way through your adult life. Because the adult life can be dreary, tiring, and repetitive. To have a passion makes that better. Dedicating yourself to a passion, to a purpose, is admirable. It is challenging. It's rewarding. It's frustrating. It can be heart-wrenching. But ultimately, we hope that spiritually and mentally, it will be fulfilling. But to live your life according to some master plan, based on a future notion of who or what you want to be, will most likely not at all be fulfilling. I'm not sure what sort of 30-year-olds would emerge at the end of the elite daily 20-point tunnel, but I'm pretty sure I wouldn't like them. Those foolish enough to plan every detail of their life will find that, as John Lennon so perfectly said, life is what happens when you're busy making other plans. I noticed that song well, nice job. And as much as I love the students that are sitting up here, it amazes me sometimes to hear of their future lives that they already have planned out. There is no way I'm getting married before I achieve my personal goals. Well, I'll do my degree, and then a few years of work, and then I'll do an MBA. But because this is AES, occasionally you're here, I'll do a spell on the Peace Corps, and then I'll get a job in the Diplomatic Corps. Or most commonly, from the girls, I'm going to take a career break in my 30s to have kids. To be fair, I think I thought like this. And now I think I know the following, which in 10 years I may not necessarily agree with. But I have those goals. But life is not a yellow brick road to the end, with a nice house on a lake and lashings of grandchildren, a nice Pinot Noir, and plenty of exotic cruises. To know this, you only have to look at your classmates. Sitting on the stage last year was Baron Banta. He was polite, helpful, friendly, and intellectually brilliant. He went to one of the best universities in North America. Baron had the world at his feet. He had great plans, he had it all mapped out, and then one day, in his second month at university, he got hit by a bus. Now, he's okay. And also, don't ask me how, he managed to make his 16 years in Delhi without a scratch, and then gets hit by one of the three buses in Canada. But Baron managed. But when Baron woke up, he had brain damage, and he could hardly remember a thing from the last 2 years. Baron was as hard a working kid as you will ever find, damn smart. But everything that he had lined up was in danger of being taken away by chance, by ill fate. And Varen isn't the only one. Think about your own Irby Shum or Irby. Irby, in 1 hour, taught me to draw upside down, and I was very proud of him. Well, I did under a guidance, thank you, Irby. But regardless, Irby got kicked in the face violently whilst playing soccer and was rushed to hospital for surgery. All anyone could think of, as we heard snippets of news in the preceding hours and days, was, well, what's Irby going to do if she loses her eye? How will she draw if she loses her eye? And it was touch and go for a while. But in the end, a simple ice pack applied by Mrs. Barley saved her eye. Her future, her dreams, her passions hung by a thread, and in the end, some ice saved it all. Now the point I'm moving to is that both Baron and Irby had it all. They got lots of talent, lots of ideas. They know where they're going. But looking the wrong way at a crossing, or making a brave save, could have cost them their dreams. Thankfully, they're both back to 100%. But the point of their stories is that it doesn't take much to bring your dreams crashing down. Maybe you get hit by a bus, or kicked in the face, or a baby comes along. Surprise! Oh, you will be. Now, it's a wonderfully romantic idea that all of you, at some point, will take to your dreams. And some of you will, and I tip my invisible hat to you for that one. But for the rest of us, Our plans change, for better or for worse. Your path from here isn't easy. You can try to control it. You can try to plan it all out, and many of you will. But you can't. We all hope for a smooth ride, but like James Rhodes, it's unlikely. If things don't go to plan, you need to remember a few things. One, you are loved. Outside of your creation, the reason you have family is for help and love. The reason you have friends is for help and love. Whether you have 2 or 200, it doesn't matter. There are people who love you and will help you no matter what. And you can see many of them here tonight, and I hope that remains the case forever. Second, plenty of people have been hit hard and kept going, so can you. As Vincent Cassell said, it doesn't matter how you fall, it's how you land. And lastly, the most important piece of advice I can give you is this. Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and curse. But when you're chewing on life's gristle, don't grumble, give a whistle. And this will help things turn out for the best. Always think of the dark side of
One of the most critical reasons for its success, however, lies with one man, our director, who has time and again proved to enforce the motto that this school stands for: enter to learn, leave to serve. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to present to you Captain Barship, presenting the commencement address, Dr. Hazard.
Rode off without him. That's what happened. The farmer's neighbor was passing by. this happened, and he said, how happy, what good luck. And the farmer responded, we'll see, we'll see. Now graduates, I am certain it comes as no surprise to you that life is unpredictable and that does not always turn out the way you want it. It's filled with wonderment, magic, and pure joy. And unfortunately also disappointment. And even at times sadness. As filmmaker Woody Allen observed, life is full of misery, loneliness, and suffering, and then it's all over much too soon. Now I might add, this is not the poignant insight, I promise. Rather, that insight comes from Viktor Frankl. Viktor Frankl was a rising star in the world of psychiatry in Austria, about the same time that Churchill gave his commencement address. He was also Jewish. As the plight of Nazism grew, rather than flee Austria, he made the courageous choice to stay on with his family and care for them. Eventually, they were all sent to concentration camps. And Dr. Frankl was the only member of his family to survive. Now, his experiences in that camp led to his book, Man's Search for Meaning. And in this book is the insightful quote that I hold so dear. Dr. Frankl wrote the following: we who lived in concentration camps can remember the men who walked through huts comforting others, giving away their last piece of bread. They may have been few in number, but they offered sufficient proof that everything can be taken from a man but one thing, the last of human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way. Graduates, as for what the future holds, well, we'll see, we'll see. Remember that no matter what lies ahead, you always have a choice, and that is to choose your own way. My sincerest wish is that all your dreams are fulfilled and that you're bold enough to dream big. I also want you to remember this night, around this stage in this audience, our friends and family that share those dreams and who hold an enormous affection and love for you. And this, graduates, is something you must never, ever, never, ever, ever give up. Thank you.
Zia Onan Akbar.
Christopher A. Haring.
Hyun-Soo Kim. Nikhil Kohler.
Snyder, Veneersman. Kaur Sarang. Colveen Kaur Sarna.
Assist us in graduating this extraordinary class of young women and young men. Having successfully completed the requirements for graduation from high school at the American Embassy School of New Delhi, India, and having now received your diplomas, I ask that you each, together, move your tassels from the right side of your caps to the left side of your caps. You are no longer high school students, you are high school graduates.